He's right here. I didn't know that he was going to be here. So please stand up and be counted. He worked for 2 years with Kanu on the script. And he suffered everything that we suffered. So, yeah. That's the man behind the screenplay of Tithli.
Dibakar, one question. After writing a screenplay, directing, producing, and like almost getting killed by Bunty, what's next on your list? Like, what are you going to do now after...
Answer when you ask me that 20 years from now, another film. There's nothing else I can do.
So do you have something in mind right now?
Obviously, how will I put food on my table?
Apart from Vyomkesh.
That's all I have right now. I mean, it's too much to think beyond that.
When are you looking to release the three in India?
Well, that's the million-dollar question that YRF, DBP, and Guneet, we will figure out. Our first aim is to give Tithli the full share of spotlight in Cannes. I mean, in the ways and means that Guneet just about touched upon. It's far more than what she's saying. And then we have a plan of taking Tithli to further festivals. Guneet will take you through it. And those festivals will determine what are the world markets that are opening up for Tithli. Once that process is done and once we have secured a fair share of the world market, hopefully, then we will discuss and try and see how best we can synchronize the Indian release. But more about that from the expert.
Yeah. So basically, Cannes will be the world premiere of the film, and it will also be termed as the world festival premiere of the film. It will also be the European festival premiere. After this, in a short while, we will have a really, we will have an American festival premiere, and once we cover these two massive continents with Tithli, it will spread out to a lot of more festivals around the world. That will give it a chance for a lot of distributors and cinema lovers from around the world to see it and bring that out. And India release will be in sync with various territory release. And this is a journey that you have to take for the next 3 to 4 months for us to come to a date across the world.
It's a film that has several themes that it's working on. Patriarchy is just one of them. I think the strongest point of the film is that it's a film about family. All of us have families, whether it's a guy sitting in Japan or it's a guy sitting in Malaysia or in Iceland. Everybody has had a family. Everybody has lived through the close relationships or the closest relationships that the film is talking about. So it's got a bunch of characters who are behaving, talking, looking, not speaking to each other in ways that all of us have done. And I think that is the strongest point of the film. It's talking about people that all of us feel like we know very intimately. That said, that being the central theme, it's then talking about a lot of other things, one being patriarchy, which will connect it to various audiences around the world. For some, patriarchy might be a stronger theme to latch onto. For another person, they might find the relationship between the boy and girl the most interesting thing to latch onto. That might become their mirror to see the film through. But I think the real central universality of the film lies in the fact that it's about a family of five people trying to coexist or trying to negotiate this world that they've created together.
YRF, because Adi and I were in talks to do this YRF DBP co-production when the final draft or the middle draft of Tithli was there, and for me to be absolutely sure that I was going to produce it. and when I spoke to Adi and we were talking about our slate, I said that there's this film that I'm on fire about and I want to produce it before I produce anything else, including my own film. So, and when he learned that it was Titli, he was very excited. And that is when we decided that we would start the YRF DBP slate with something as small, yet as exceptional and a kind of an outlier like Titli, because it would be a new thing for both of us. And that's how the excitement started. This is not common knowledge, but the script of Titli was known already. It had already found a name for itself. It was quite, everybody was talking about it within the industry, those who knew. Titli was also a part of the NFDC Script Lab, which is a unique product where promising screenplay ideas compete for an extended 3 weeks, 2 weeks workshop.
For about a couple of months, actually.
An extended couple of months workshop where that script is guided by various guides through various stages of completion so that it can explore to the fullest extent its theme. And by the time the NFDC Script Lab finished, by the time Titli as a script was known to a few of the Bombay film industry, we all knew that we had pretty much of a golden sort of, you know, product in hand. And Titli as a screenplay was already known amongst the people who know. Not for the public domain, but amongst the enthusiasts and amongst the, and that's how Adi had also heard about it. So when I spoke to him about Titli, he had already kind of read a draft of it, he already knew about it, and that's how it started. As I'm saying again and again, Titli found its own life. Nobody had to do anything for Titli to be selected into NFDC Script Lab. Nobody had to do anything for Titli's screenplay to be noticed by people. Nobody had to do anything for Titli to be selected by Cannes Film Festival. They came, they saw the rough cut, and they said they wanted it. So Titli has found its own life, and I'm sure it would have found the same life without DBP and YRF. And I think that's the best strength that you can give to a film, that it can walk on its two legs.
Can you please tell us what is the music about? Because we haven't really heard anything about it.
Well, the score is by Karan Gaur, there are no songs per se in the film, so it's a background score that you have to hear, and it sort of sticks with you. That's my opinion, but you have to hear the score and. So there are five principal characters in the film. There are the three brothers, Vikram, Bavla, and Titli. Vikram is played by Ranveer Shori. Bavla is played by Amit Seyal. Titli is played by Shashank Arora. It's a debut for him. And then there's the character of Neelu, who Titli marries in the film. That's played by Shivani Raghuvanshi. That's again a debut. And then there's the character of the father, and that's played by Lalit Behel. And that again is a debut. So out of the five principals, three are a debut.
Is it somehow related to you? By the way, Lalit Behel, who's the father of the patriarchal unit in the film, is also Kanu's father. And he apparently was cast for a wonderful cardiac surgery scar on his chest. And we didn't have to spend money for makeup. I'm just kidding. He has the scar that really works for the film. But Kanu's father is an actor and a producer of plays, theater, and television in Delhi. And Kanu kind of forced him into acting as the father. And I think it's a coup, because it really affects you. It really affects you in the way that you didn't imagine it would affect you. Let me warn you, Titli is a film, and I'm being unashamed here, Titli is a film, no matter whether you like it or not like it, Titli is a film that will leave you affected for a long time. So, it's something to grapple with. It's something to negotiate with, and that's what the cast stands for. I also think it's Ranveer Shori's career best performance. His career best performance, I've said it on record, you can quote me. It is Ranveer Shori's career best performance. He's topped Khosla Ka Khosla, I'm very proud to say. And I'm also very personally proud that a fine actor like Amit Syal, whose face I showed probably for about three minutes in all of Love, Sex or Dhoka. He was a prime protagonist in Love, Sex or Dhoka. But because he was carrying the Sting camera, poor guy's face was never seen. But his presence was felt throughout. So Amit Syal is seen and a fine, fine actor. And you can see what a tremendous actor he is. And what a tremendous support he gives to the film. And it is one of the best acted films that I've seen after a long, long time, where you are not even aware that the actors are acting. But this is the film enthusiast in me talking. A lot of the credit, along with Kanu, goes to Atul Mongia, the associate director of the film, who also was the casting director and the workshop director of Love, Sex or Dhoka, and Shanghai as well. So Atul Mongia is another person to watch out for, because he's contributed in many unsaid ways to many, many films like Love, Sex or Dhoka and Titli, with a tremendous cast and a tremendous workshop, a preparation for the actors, which gives the director what he needs.
Thank you.